way which has been postulated, which is one of the original ways that was being postulated, was that we capture the sum total of all human knowledge and put it into systems that could then be able to utilize that knowledge to come up with how it would perceive and deal with the world. Now, there are fundamental problems with this. Okay, so first thing is you don't know what you know. A lot of our knowledge is implicit. It's not explicit. You don't. The fact that I am Anand is fine, but what constitutes a human body, what is a face, so on and so forth, are things that you have learned growing up. It's not something that you have assigned labels necessarily. So there's a lot of knowledge that is extremely implicit in how we perceive and deal with the world. So this isn't captured if you try to dump the sum total of all human knowledge, if that were even possible, and we had a large enough database. Now, the second problem with this is that we're extremely delusional. You don't actually know what you're seeing. What you're seeing is an illusion created by your brain out of incomplete parts. So an example I'm pretty fond of repeating, so unfortunately, if you've ever heard me talk before, bear with me. You have 3 red pixels racing right at you. What are they? It's hard to answer that question when you don't have enough information about the context. Add context, it's a cricket stadium. You all know what the answer is. Add context, you're in the middle of a food fight. You know exactly what it is. Now, the context allows you to understand what those 3 pixels could be. Extremely insufficient, low-resolution information can still be deciphered because of the context, and you are expecting something like that. Now, what do you do about that? Well, that's, yeah. So that's not necessarily going to be very different. If a cricket ball or an apple is rushing at your head, you probably need to duck anyways. So the third part, which I've already alluded to, is that there's simply too much knowledge out there. You can't possibly capture everything. The sum total of our knowledge, well, forget our knowledge. Our knowledge itself is a subset of reality. So we simply can't capture all that information. So if you try to build a system that is dependent on the amount of knowledge you've put into this, you're not going to get anywhere. Okay, so fine. So let's assume that's not how you're going to go about building a brain. So the second way you could do it is say, hey, I know humans are intelligence. Humans have brains. Brains seem to be the seat of the mind and intelligence. Let's assume that's not controversial. Why don't we study brains? Why don't we dissect everything that is to know, study every connection, every neuron in your brain, and actually recreate it? Would that constitute a thinking machine? Again, highly unlikely. So the numbers are not in our favor. You have on the order of 80 billion neurons in your brain, trillions of connections, and these connections are the seat of memory. If nobody goes into that kind of detail, I'll probably cover some of it tomorrow in the workshop. But those connections that hold your memories, trillions of those connections, are about 1 micron in size. And the gap between two cells that the synapse makes is 10 nanometers. We don't have the tools that can even scratch at being able to record what actual content is there in these trillion connections. So that doesn't sound very likely. But let's just say you can actually read brain states. And you can actually try and, with all the neuroscience resources on this planet, you figure out a lot about how what's actually in a brain. How do you actually go about building it? How faithful are you going to be in your reproduction of that brain? Are you going to model neurons? Are you going to model networks? Are you going to model ion channels? Or are you going to go down to the quantum level? Every single researcher out there has a very different answer as to how important these different levels are. If you take somebody like the Brain Project in Europe and Henry Markram and what he does, he believes that you need to study a lot of detail down to the ion channel levels, model them in extremely excruciating details, maybe model 10,000 neurons at a time on a supercomputer, and maybe that will give you sufficient information about the microcircuitry in a brain. He may be right, but we don't know. And so but that does seem to be the only way to go forward. We have to build models. We have to build lots of models. We have to try a lot of different variations on how we think brains are built, how machines can think. And through the failures, through the successes, we actually end up capturing a lot of this. OK, so given that backdrop, let's see how we actually did it in history. And for the next few slides, at least, I'll start talking a little bit about what has happened. Again, this is a very brief history, and we'll have a lot of holes, so forgive me for that. But let's start off with something fairly recent. So in the 1940s, McCullough and Pitts suggested that you could capture a brain's neuron by a very simple model. So we know that neurons in the brain have essentially three major components. They have dendrites. These dendrites are like tree-like structures that gather inputs. So you have inputs, that's represented over here. And then these dendrites modulate those inputs. So you have weights so that they can modulate them. And then you sum up all of that in the cell body called a soma. And then you apply some kind of a nonlinear function, and you get the output of a neuron. Now, this is actually a pretty good model of a neuron. It glosses over all the nonlinearities and all the ion channels and extreme complexities that go into what is actually in a biophysical neuron. But it does capture the overall goal. Neurons do integrate information from multiple inputs, and they sum it and say, hey, I think all my inputs were sufficient. They crossed the threshold. I can fire and pass on that information. This led to eventually Rosenblatt and stuff coining the term perceptron to describe this kind of a model. And the world was excited. The world was extremely excited. Now we could actually build lots of neural networks. These have the potential to actually do a lot of computation. What can they actually do? Well, you put a neural network, you connect a lot of these things together, and you can actually start doing a little bit of classification. You have inputs that are different. They get integrated across these neurons. And you can tune those weights to be able to actually differentiate between different classes of input. Okay, so just a little bit of jargon over here. In any high-dimensional input, if you want to be able to separate them out into classes, what you do is you use n minus 1 dimensions in something to construct what's something called a hyperplane. So if you're two dimensions, your hyperplane is essentially just a linear line. So these linear neurons, essentially, could end up doing a lot of classification. And everybody was ecstatic. Okay? They were so ecstatic that based on Rosenblatt's comments, the New York Times essentially said, hey, we're going to be able to create conscious entities. You have, and not using the neural network type of approach, you had the other side of AI also making similar claims, saying, hey, we're going to be able to build machines that can think within 20 years. Humans, forget it. You're going to build much more intelligent beings. All of this happened in the 50s and 60s. Now, as you can imagine, their predictions were way off. They simply did not grasp how difficult the problem is. Everything I said in the first couple of slides, talking about how difficult this problem is, somehow slipped them. These are very smart people. So it's not necessarily that they didn't think about the problems. They were just overly optimistic. Now, Minsky famously, along with Papert, I think that's the pronunciation, published a book on perceptrons, which was pretty good. He illustrated the potential of perceptrons, but then he did a little bit of disservice when he started dissing the perceptron and what it could do. But one thing he did observe there, and while there's a lot of controversy about what Minsky said about perceptrons and whether that is responsible for the first AI winter, I'm going to add one extra thing. Minsky also pointed out that, sure, let's say you can actually build these wonderful neural networks and do all of this computation, you don't have enough computational power to actually build anything useful. And I think that also severely contributed to the first AI winter. So for the next decade, all funding dried up. DARPA contracts were canceled. Everybody on this planet was pretty much annoyed with everybody who claimed that they were doing AI. And research came to a grinding halt. So you had, so, and remember, all of this is based on something as simple as a perceptron whose weights were handcrafted. They were assigned to solve problems, and all the problems solved were toy problems. Well, so this is not entirely chronologically accurate, so I'm going to take a little liberty over there. But while the while the artificial intelligence and machine learning, neural networks kind of people were wallowing in their misery about their dried up funding, let's see what the neuroscience world was doing. So the perceptron was one abstraction, one representation of what a neuron could be. But that's not the only thing you can actually learn from the brain. And the neuroscientists continued chugging along. And there were a few things that stand out in these intervening years that they observed that will come back when we talk about the resurgence of machine learning. So first thing, it's a huge mouthful. But this is essentially Hebb's postulate. So Donald Hebb, in case you haven't heard his name, you should. The word Hebbian learning comes from his name. He observed that, and this is a very bad paraphrasing, but the world uses it a lot, cells that fire together, wire together. That's the bad paraphrasing of this sentence that he actually did. So what he observed was, your brain was actually trying to figure out causality. And neural networks, and neurons in particular, were looking for other neurons that could reflect their view of the world, and trying to find correlations and associations across those things. This Hebbian learning has been the cornerstone of a lot of neuroscience research since then. It still drives a lot of the machine learning work that's happening. Now, another observation, which is also pretty critical, I think, was Hubel and Wiesel in the 60s making recordings from cat brains. I think it was cat brains. I think they recorded from a bunch of animals, but let's just talk about cat brains. And they were recording from the primary visual cortex of these animals. And what they observed when they presented visual stimulus to anesthetized cats, was that the cells responded in two ways. There were a class of cells that simply integrated and responded to what was underlying them. So if you think of a neuron in the brain and the whole of visual space that it's responding to, they responded to a tiny portion in visual space, and they actually summed up the inputs that impinged your retina. And the result of this was very simple cells that were responsive to edges, bars of light, and spots, and so on and so forth. Simple cells. Okay, that's fine. In machine learning parlance, that's a feature descriptor. Okay, now, or that's a feature that you've described. Anyways, they observed a second class of cells. These were called complex cells. Now, what the complex cells seemed to do was they were integrating a lot of simple cells. Now, this is important because if you have a whole bunch of simple cells that are responding to vertical lines, and they're near each other, but they're slightly displaced in space in the brain, and correspondingly displaced in visual space, as to which region of visual space they're responding to, and you combine these inputs, it means that whether the bar was here, or here, or here, this complex cell would be responding to it. Now, if you go back to the themes of what I said were important, this is essentially spatial invariance. Okay? So these cells are now responding to bars of light, regardless of where exactly they happen. Okay? We'll come back to this, but fine, I'll give away some of the story already. This is the harbinger of pooling, which a lot of you are familiar with. So we'll get to that in a bit. Okay. So meanwhile, some other guys were trying to put together larger networks. Okay. So these guys were trying to build these networks, and I'm just pointing out two of them which stand out to me. One was called the neocognitron. Okay. So the neocognitron, regardless of the name and the intentions behind that name, had a layered architecture that was based on what Hubel and Wiesel observed. Okay? So what they had was, if you have input, that's visual space, you had a layer of simple cells followed by a layer of the first thing is probably, the contrast extraction is the equivalent of a retina. Let's skip past that. You have a layer of simple cells that are doing things like edge extraction and stuff. Then you have a complex layer, which is giving you slightly invariant representations of those same features. And then you have another pair of those, and so on and so forth, cascading these layers together. And you build a classifier on the top layer and see whether it can recognize things. So this is pretty cool. And for those of you who recognize this architecture, this is a convolutional net. We'll come to that again in the end. So we're going to bind this all together. But I will keep giving away the clues if they're not obvious. But everything was done. There were lots of theory, lots of experiments that have laid the foundation for modern machine learning. I'm just pointing those out because the lesson to be taken is that neuroscience is continuing to do this. Neuroscientists out there are, I don't know, 100,000 maybe, 50 to 100,000 neuroscientists out there in the world that are doing fundamental research that's contributing things like this. And these are the things that are being exploited and being reused in the world of machine learning with very good reason. They're good and they work. Okay? So another network which I really like is called the Hopfield network. While Hopfield wasn't the first person to actually build these kind of networks, he became associated with these networks a lot. And so John Hopfield built these networks that actually had a whole bunch of recurrent connections. So this is one of the first recurrent neural networks that was out there. And he found that it had a lot of potential applications in associative learning. These networks, depending on how they were configured, were capable of associating patterns that came in and ending up with stable states that represented the memories stored in them. I know, quite a handful. We can go into greater detail about these things offline. If you want any level of detail and you're feeling lost, talk to me later. And also, if some of you are hitting the workshop tomorrow, I'll be running the vision workshop, so you can also save your questions for that as well, because I'll be available for a whole 4 hours, right? Okay, so you have ConvNets and you have RNNs, done in the 80s. Examples of them that kind of worked and demonstrated pretty cool features. Okay? And then it was back. Machine learning came back. The world celebrated again with the invention of the backpropagation algorithm. I mentioned that those perceptron layers were all handcrafted, right? So obviously not scalable. So when somebody came up with a rule that would allow you to actually train that entire set of weights to map out all those input-output functions, people got excited again. So you now had a mathematical basis for training multi-layer perceptrons that could now learn extremely complex input-output functions. Sounds great. Everybody started investing in artificial neural networks. You had a huge resurgence. And it fell flat again. Because again, unfortunately, so multiple reasons, but I would like to attribute one major reason. You still did not have enough compute power to be able to run large enough networks to make a difference. You were still running toy problems. Sure, they made a few things that actually worked, maybe in handwriting recognition and so on and so forth. But you couldn't get past that. There was a huge bottleneck. You didn't have large enough machines, not enough RAM, not enough compute power. You still can't build large enough networks to make this useful. And not enough data. We'll get to that separately. But so this essentially led to a little bit of interest. It flared up again, but subsided. Now, the difference between the first AI mentor and the second one was things didn't just go quietly, because there were lots of intelligent people who recognized this for its power and continued doing very credible research. So again, I can't do justice to all the different gains that happened in this period. But despite the lack of compute power, a lot of very good people reassembled under the term machine learning and did a lot of good work. Okay, so I'll point out a few things, and Lynette is of importance because Lynette is was actually done for handwriting recognition, and you have Jan LeCun to thank for the Lynette, I think. for people who don't recognize his name, he runs Facebook's AI today. Support vector machines. Now, these were very interesting. So, support vector machines came at a time that was perfect. Neural networks couldn't really do too much, and support vector machines had been around. So, Wapnick was one of the guys who invented them a little while ago, in the 60s or 70s. But in the 90s, what happened was they came up with something called a kernel trick. So when I pointed out that you could draw these simple hyperplanes to separate out the data, what would happen when your data was a lot more complex? Like, let's say it was a donut hole shaped thing. It's a very common thing. If you Google it up, you will find, just Google up kernel trick, and you'll find these data sets that are very hard to classify by putting a linear separator between them. Okay, but what made support vectors really powerful was, in addition to being very good at doing linear classification, if you applied these kernel tricks, you could transform the data essentially into a different space, a different manifold that would allow you to then put linear classifiers and separate out your data. So that was really cool, and it got a lot of popularity. In fact, people still use a lot of those kind of things. Skip a few things. A lot of self-organizing map-related stuff came out of neuroscience. Again, we'll skip them. Everybody has probably heard of SIFT. SIFT was, again, based on observations about the human visual system, the nature of the receptive fields and all that kind of stuff in the visual cortex. Got translated into Gabor pyramids and all of those kind of stuff. And and one of the consequences is SIFT. It's been the mainstay for a lot of object recognition for a while. I have done complete injustice to my fellow NLP-related guys, but sorry, I'm a vision person, so I have a very, I have an extreme bias towards thinking about vision-related problems. But those guys have been chugging along. They were not necessarily affected by the lack of data or the compute power, because they could actually make do with what was there. And a lot of good work, especially in recurrent neural networks, happened during this period. Culminating in LSTMs, which I think were invented in around the 97. I forget the names of the guys. Again, sorry, my bias, not an NLP guy. But LSTMs are still state of the art in a lot of this kind of in a lot of NLP research. So I'll skip HMax. That's fine. So the interlude basically had steady progress. People were making very good models, but doing it with the limited resources that were there. And then, of course, you have your sponsors over here who had GPUs, and they released CUDA. Okay, so this is really cool. So finally, you had compute power. This is exciting. Graphics cards, they observed, were extremely good at doing all of these actions in parallel. And neural networks seem to be an embarrassingly parallel problem that you could shove onto a graphics card. And even the first versions of them were doing wonders. So I have the good fortune of having somebody named Costa Colbert as one of the founding members of Math3Den. So Costa, anecdotally, and this is interesting, Costa was part of a company named Evolved Machines in Palo Alto. And Evolved Machines was like the second company ever listed in NVIDIA using CUDA to build a neural computation engine. So when these guys came out with this, starting in the mid-2000s, I can't put an exact date to it, people saw the value of it and started adopting it. Okay? And one of the people who adopted it was a guy named Jeffrey Hinton. Again, if you don't recognize the name, he kind of heads Google's AI. Now, Jeffrey Hinton took all that compute power, took those neural networks, and said, yeah, I can train them, but they're not converging very well. Okay? So he contributed something called a deep belief network. I'm sure he's not fond of deep belief networks, the name, but let me just explain what he did. What he observed was, with a limited set of data, despite all this computational power that you had, you really couldn't train your neural networks to converge very well. It was very hard to do so. So instead, he pre-trained those networks using these things called restricted Boltzmann machines. Again, a lot more detail tomorrow in the workshop. I'll keep it short. The idea was that he built generative networks, networks that were very good at representing their own inputs. And he trained them in a greedy fashion that set up these networks so that they could converge very well when subsequently trained with backpropagation and all the compute resources that NVIDIA's GPUs provided to them. Okay, so that was great. And so he had a lot of success with that. And in particular, these RBMs turned out to be very good at building autoencoders. So you could train an RBM network, unroll it, and since it's generative, you could actually use it to train an autoencoder and train it with backprop. So some of the applications, a lot of the applications were mostly hinged on these kind of things. Now, okay. So as I mentioned, he found that this was very effective because he now had the GPUs and he had the algorithms that could be used and thrown at these to solve these classification problems. But what he found and what a bunch of other people found was that if you had a ton of data as well, you actually didn't even need to pre-train the network. And so came, And this is essentially the world of Google today. You have a ton of data out there. So you do have the data, you now have the algorithms, and you have the compute engine. What can you actually build with it? Now, if you take these networks, the traditional neural networks that you're working with, these tend to be fully connected. So let me see if, yeah, over here. So the idea is that every cell is connected to every other cell in the next layer, and you try to compute all of these weight matrices that will actually give you the computation that you need. Problem is, you'll quickly run out of memory. And as good as NVIDIA GPUs are, they do have limited memory. So you can't train absurdly large networks using this kind of technology. So flashback to the neocognitron, where you could use convolutions instead. So there's an observation that's been made when you study a lot of these things, which is when you are processing information, particularly visual, I'm sure the NLP guys will be able to contribute to that discussion on the other front. But when you're talking about visual information, there is a very high spatial correlation amongst inputs that are right next to each other. If that weren't so, I wouldn't be able to make sense out of this scene. Out of this scene in front of me right now, right? Each one of you is spatially localized. It's not as if parts of you are split across my entire visual scene that I have to actually combine this information. So if that is true, why do I need a weight matrix that actually combines all of these? I can actually keep a very tiny weight matrix that's looking at a tiny subset of visual space. Okay? So assume that's true. If you can do that, then what you can do is analyze if you can train a whole bunch of these tiny little receptive fields. And the observations that come out of that from both neuroscience and if you try to train a lot of these is that you will find a lot of repeated patterns. If I want to identify people on my left or to my right, the kind of receptive fields, the kind of feature detectors I need are going to be identical. People don't change just because they're on the left of my visual space or the right. I'll still need edge detectors, I'll still need spot detectors, so on and so forth. So the filter that you've just shrunk and reduced its memory requirement is actually the same that you need across the whole board. Voila, you have a convolution. So you have a filter bank that essentially captures one type of parameter and tries to see whether an entire scene has these features by convolving it. So the benefits from this, very low memory footprint, because the only thing you need to store are the parameters of that convolution, the convolutional filter. And so now you can train extremely large networks, have lots of feature descriptors, and churn it through your GPUs and train it on a ton of data, which Google and others provide. And you now have state-of-the-art neural networks. And the example over here, in case you don't recognize the name, his full name is Alex Krizevsky. And this is essentially your AlexNet. For the people who have heard of that, that's the origin of your AlexNet. I'm assuming it's named after him. Yes, okay, sure. So the AlexNet came out of Hinton's lab in 2012 and took on these challenges that the world was throwing at them. So you had all these image recognition challenges and blew it out of the water. And that, maybe not exactly that, but things like that, including the AlexNet winning the competition in that particular year, got the whole world interested in deep convolutional nets. And it hasn't looked back, and the whole world essentially uses a ton of these to do a lot of different things. And the interesting part for most people, even if you're not into deep learning per se, is the huge plethora of applications that can then be addressed by these kind of classifiers. That now you can train reasonably reliably, extremely fast. And when I say extremely fast, we've gone from years to months to weeks on a ton of data so that you don't need to necessarily handcraft those features or do anything. It can probably figure out the representation by itself when you have enough data. And it does pretty well. How well does it do? It beats humans at specific tasks. So the ImageNet challenge is about doing a 1,000 class classifier, essentially. If you put a human against one of these networks, not necessarily the AlexNet, but the subsequent winners in following years, they probably beat most of us in this auditorium. You need to be a very special human to be able to beat one of these things. However, they still don't drive your cars by themselves. If it's not just about object recognition, it's not just about language processing, you need to assemble all of these subsystems to actually make something useful out of it. I'll leave you with one last thought. The progress in the field is about not just exploiting and building deeper nets, it's about how do you assemble these things, these subsystems as I mentioned, and make more interesting things. So an example is an application of image captioning, where this has been done fairly successfully. So if you're trying to describe this image, it's not a classification problem by itself. You also need to have a grammar that represents what's actually in here. So there have been some pretty good examples of using the power of deep CNN to do the image classification related parts, and then assemble the words, the labels that come out of that, and pass it through very powerful networks, recurrent neural networks that the NLP guys have been creating. And now you have some pretty credible captioning networks that can do this. So this is just the beginning. This is just the start. The whole world is ahead of anybody who actually wants to get into deep learning, and hopefully go beyond deep learning and do things, start extracting more from the world of neuroscience. As I mentioned, everything you've seen here has come out of studying the brain and trying to model it. So I would hope at least a portion of you would try to do that, as we try to do at MathStreet then, and continue the development of machine learning. So I'll stop over here and open it up if you have any questions.
Actually, this is Siva.
Where are you? Sorry.
Okay. So, I mean, my understanding from this talk is it's a lot of image classification and predicting the actions from an image, that perspective. And
could you speak a bit louder? I can't hear you.
A lot of image classification, the actions, the patterns recognition.
Sure.
Those of it. Which are already there. That's one part. My question is how different is this deep learning in terms of machine learning? Like, is there an application of deep learning in a banking domain? Just trying to see, or it's only limited to image and image processing, or in terms of how would you say deep learning versus machine learning part in terms of applications? I mean.
Sure. So I'm not going to answer that completely. There's a whole bunch of very good speakers who are lined up who are going to be talking about applications in different domains and stuff like that. So again, I repeat, this overview is biased by the fact that I work on vision primarily, but there are lots of other domains in which deep learning can be used to sift through the patterns that are applicable in that. Is that essentially what you were asking about?
Yeah. I think probably other sessions also will give a little bit more clarity. And another question is, can I assume deep learning as the next level of image processing or computer vision topic? Like, I've seen a bit of this shift and edge detection, all this stuff, but not gone beyond that in terms of really trying out. So is it something that the next, if you wanted to do advanced computer vision stuff,
if you wanted to do
advanced computer vision,
yes,
that topic, it's closely correlated to deep learning.
So rather than putting it that way, I'll rephrase it and say deep learning techniques currently are the reigning champions on computer vision related tasks. Thanks to their power. So they have beaten the reigning champions of SIFT and so on and so forth by how they've been applied. It's not to say that you can't build hybrid networks that take what you've learned using SIFT and finding a hybrid that actually takes it beyond where it is right now. But yes, if you are serious about computer vision research, you do have to go through deep learning currently.
Cool. Thank you very much. Thanks.
Hi, my name is Rajesh. I'm from the DDA team, a Chennai-based consulting firm.
Could you speak up? Keep it closer.
Yeah, my name is Rajesh. I'm from the DDA team. We're a Chennai-based consulting firm. My two-part question, actually. So first question is, do you envision moving from a special purpose system, like the ones that we talked about, like image recognition, image processing, to a general purpose? And what does that paradigm shift require in terms of technological?
Right. What would you require to actually make it more generalizable? Now, there's no easy answer to that. Part of it would have to be with the creation of new networks and network architectures that are capable of generalizing better than these are. But that's kind of a cop-out, right? Taking the existing networks themselves, what needs to be done is to figure out how you could actually assemble a system that builds on previous system capabilities. Okay, so I'm being a little vague over here. Okay, so you have the backbone of a network that, at its fundamental level, parses through the raw data for you. All of these networks, all the winners of all these image competitions and so on and so forth, have done that work for you. Now, what you can do is use that as a template to actually piggyback on that and build systems that take part or assemble multiple versions of those in order to make it more generalizable. The problem is that's not intuitively satisfying. You would rather have the generalization be inherent in the architecture. And going back to my first answer, that's still an avenue of research.
Right. No, I guess in relation to what you said, one thought that I had was when we improve a machine learning system or a deep learning system, it's usually done to improve its efficiency or its efficacy at doing one task, right? Now, how do we spread that out across a range of tasks or?
Could you repeat that? And speak up a little, I can't hear you.
So when you, some time back you just said, when you improve a system and then it gets better at what it is used to doing, what it's supposed to be doing, you improve its efficacy or you improve its efficiency at doing one thing. But then when you spread that effort out across a range of systems, then they'd have to work together, different networks would have to work together in the same architecture. So is that one area that you foresee as?
Yes, sure. So how networks would communicate with each other. If you take the last example I showed you guys, where you've essentially slapped an RNN on top of a CNN, that's not networks working with each other. That's taking the output of a CNN, feeding it into another network that is good at dealing with labels. Now, if your captioning system was able to actually feed back a little context and tweak how the visual network was actually performing so that the labels that came out were more relevant. Now you're talking. And it might have a lot more power in that. So it's not just assembly of disparate parts and then you try to figure out how it works. You have to actually figure out how they actually merge together. And there are people trying to do that, and but it's not something that's borne fruit yet.
I think we have time for just one more question before the next speaker takes up on stage.
Yeah, hi. I was just wondering, I am the founder of a computer vision firm, and in my past life, have worked on quite a bit of computer vision problems. Just wondering, because computer vision is and machine learning are getting so closely tied with each other, is it the purview of Google's and Facebook's alone who can afford the GPUs, the massive data, the training sets, the investment that is required to that goes into training, or is there a larger group of companies or people who could find niches in doing things of value with good accuracy?
Absolutely. So this is not just the purview of Google or Facebook. Sure, they have a ton of data. Sure, they have a lot of money to spend on GPUs. But GPUs are not that expensive. The good folks at NVIDIA have made them fairly cheap. You can actually build a GPU cluster with your gaming cards. You don't necessarily have to use Teslas unless you're deploying them.
It's not just about the cost of the GPUs, but also what is the value that you get out of the use case that you have. Right now, very few use cases of immense value are being handled, right? So while the cost of the hardware will go down,
there are
a bunch of, some sort of a long tail of use cases which are not getting attacked right now.
Correct. And that is the world of the startup. Absolutely. That is what startups need to be tackling. You don't go head on with Google, but Google can't cover the world. Neither can Facebook. There are a plethora of use cases that are out there that will, quite frankly, Google will not even bother to try and solve those problems because they're too tiny for Google's attention. But that could still be a $100 million company right out of solving those use cases. So the resources are there in terms of compute power. A GPU instance is not that expensive, and you have access to a lot of them, even if you don't have a physical cluster at your space. You have all of these cloud providers now having GPU instances. Now, with all due respect to NVIDIA, parallel computing is going to get cheaper and lower power and more efficient by going past GPUs, by using other technology. So, can take it offline, but there are lots of other things coming up in the realm of neuromorphic engineering and stuff like that, which will actually bring down the cost of all of this much more. Now, so you have compute power. You don't necessarily have the same amount of data that Google does, but that's where you have to be smart about it. But if you do need to go and collect data, it's not as if it's an impossible or Herculean task. Sure. There are proxies. There is crowdsourcing of data if you want things labeled. And maybe it is our job to figure out how to make do with less. And so that might actually also drive the path towards innovation. Build hybrid networks that bootstrap on the giants, but then build it in a way that uses very little data. And so those are kind of some of the things that we do in our company as well, and plenty of others.